Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. This is the show where we want you to be a part of it. And all you have to do is go through one of the ways you can do it is through our Facebook fan page. And your opinion counts. On our latest Facebook poll, we asked, do you think a 16-year-old girl should be allowed to sail around the world by herself?
Well, over 80% of you said no. However, popular opinion didn't stop today's guest from attempting to be the youngest person to sail solo around the world. Take a look.
More people have flown into outer space than have sailed solo around the globe. At just 16 years old, Abby Sunderland set out on her boat, Wild Eyes, with hopes of becoming the youngest person to sail the seas alone. But 4 months into her journey, Abby encountered a storm in the Indian Ocean. A rogue wave rolled her boat, snapped its mast, and changed Abby's course. Instead of breaking a record, she was fighting to stay alive.
Well, please welcome Abby Sunderland to 700 Club Interactive. It is great to have you here. And what a story you have to tell in your new book, Unsinkable. Abby, this vision to do this actually started for you. You did it at 16, but it began to birth in your heart at 13. Where did you get that?
Yeah, you know, it first got the idea when I was 13 years old. You know, I'd been raised around it. I grew up sailing. I can't remember a time there wasn't boats in the family. But really, the idea was born when there was just a couple of guys joking on the dock saying I was going to be the youngest girl to sail around the world alone.
And you heard that.
Yeah, I heard that. And, you know, I knew they were joking. But at the same time, I was like, that's not a bad idea. That's actually I could do that. And
how did you sell your parents on that idea? I know in the book you say that your mom, for sure, in the beginning, when you first broached the subject, said, don't even think about it. So how did you go from that to their blessing and their approval?
Yeah, well, you know, of course, when I was 13, they said no. I didn't have enough experience then. Mm-hmm. But I spent 3 years working hard, training, and, you know, trying to prove that I could do it. And eventually, they did come on board with the idea. And even my mom then was still unsure about it. And it was hard because I didn't want to do anything without my parents being fully on board.
Sure.
But once my mom saw me with my own boat and saw how serious I was about it, then she came along with the idea.
You spent 4 months in this endeavor alone at sea. I can't imagine that. I mean, I can't imagine that for myself, but I can't imagine it for a teenager because most teenagers don't want to be alone for 30 seconds. Tell me what it was like out there for you. Were you lonely? Were you afraid? What was that time like for you?
Yeah, you know, growing up around it and it was such a big part of life. I loved solo sailing. I loved being on the ocean alone. And, you know, as alone as you are, you're never really completely alone. You've always, when you're out in the ocean and, you know, you are alone, but you feel the presence of God there so much stronger than anywhere else because you don't have all the distractions of the outside world of, you know, cell phones and TV and all that. And, you know, as much as I am a normal teenager who loves all that, I also sometimes like to just separate from it and get out alone.
4 months of separation, my word, I can't imagine. And during that time, what was astonishing to me was, I want to talk about the wave that really rolled your boat and caused you to have to abandon the mission at that point. But you went through lots of storms. I mean, one never knows how long they're going to last, how bad they're going to be. Were you ever afraid?
You know, part of being a sailor is being able to control fear and also trusting your boat really well and trusting your own capability, you know. Yeah. And because of how I'd grown up, you know, there's always a little bit of fear there. You always have to have respect for the ocean. Mm-hmm. If I wasn't scared, then my parents wouldn't have let me go because I wouldn't have understood how dangerous it was. But, you know, you have to, when you're in a storm, just control your fear and deal with the problem at hand.
Talk about the problem at hand on the day that the boat turned over. What exactly happened?
Well, I had been in a storm all day, but the storm had actually died down when I was hit by the rogue wave. It was relatively calm out.
So a rogue wave just kind of comes out of nowhere and is huge? I mean, you said it was enormous.
Yeah, I didn't see it, but we're guessing probably 60-plus feet. And,
wow.
You know, sometimes it's when two waves come together. Sometimes it's just a continuous wave that's worked its way around the world or something really far and built up. We're not sure how they happen, but, you know, when they hit, it's pretty bad.
So it really caught you off guard because the storm had quieted down. And it actually rolled the boat?
360, yeah.
Wow.
Just dismasted. All my communication was out. It was a gnarly night.
So how did people find you? You lost communication at that point. All of the normal systems of communicating that you had were now unavailable to you. How did you let people know you were in trouble?
Well, once I had realized that, you know, all my communication was out and I didn't have anything left to jury rig with, I realized that, you know, I was in some serious trouble and I was going to need help. And I set off my EPIRBs, which are emergency beacon systems. They send a position to the satellites, which goes to the rescue stations. And you don't set those off unless you really need help.
Yeah.
And so they knew then.
And you were out in the middle of nowhere, so just setting those off didn't mean help was coming anytime soon, necessarily. From the time you alerted, how long before somebody got to you?
Amazingly, it was just the next day. I mean,
where
I was in the world, I was expecting a boat to come, maybe in a week. I was sitting on board my boat wondering, what can I do to make the time I'm spending out here any easier?
What did God show you during this time? I mean, you experienced so many different things. You know, first of all, having to call upon abilities that you hadn't maybe had to use in your life before, the aloneness of being out there, the fear of realizing suddenly that you were in a position of need, watching your dearly loved boat and come to a place where you knew you weren't going to be able to bring it back home with you. What did God do to you in the midst of all of that?
You know, really throughout my entire trip, I'd been growing closer to God. I was raised a Christian, and so that was just part of life as well, and you never really question it much. But on the ocean, I saw so many amazing answers to prayer. I mean, when things would go wrong, when I'd get in rough weather, my mom would send out prayer requests, and people were praying all over the world. And pretty much every single time, God would come through. And I don't think I'd be here today if it weren't for all the people around the world that were praying for me during the incident. And
you're a homeschooled young woman. I'm not going to say kid, I'll say young woman. And your family has really made some unconventional choices to raise you all living life, not in front of a TV set, not in front of an Xbox. I mean, you actually lived on boats when you were very, very young. Now you've had this very unconventional experience for a 16-year-old. How do you think those things have shaped your life and will shape your future, Abby?
You know, it's definitely, I think it's great to have a childhood like that and to grow up so differently. And, when I was growing up, it was always adventuring and, exploring beaches and building forts, and I loved it. And, having a love for adventure and things like that, it'll go with me my whole life,
It really will.
I mean, I'm going to, go back and get a driver's license and finish high school and all that. But, I'm always going to be looking for the next adventure.
And you want to read about this one. It's in her book called Unsinkable. It's available in bookstores nationwide. If you love adventure, you're going to love that Abby shares her so candidly with all of us. Abby, thank you for being with us. It's great to have you here. God bless you in all your endeavors in life. You'll hear more from her. She's got something to say. Gordon?
Well, when we come back, a young boy's prayers for his grandmother are answered, but not in the way he expected. You don't want to miss this. Stay tuned.
If you're experiencing hot flashes, night sweats, and other common symptoms of menopause, you can finally get effective relief without resorting to risky hormonal treatments. Introducing Ambrin, a natural breakthrough for managing the common symptoms of menopause,
including hot flashes, night sweats, sleep problems, irritability, difficulty concentrating, decreased libido, and more.
I couldn't believe the first day that I went without a hot flash. It was unbelievable. It was a revelation. And sleeping through the night, getting my full 8 hours of beauty sleep, it's done wonders for me.
Ambrin is clinically tested and backed by over 30 years of internationally recognized research. To further prove Ambrin's effectiveness, risk-free trials were provided to over 100,000 women. The result was an astounding 92.6% satisfaction rate.
It's science, but it feels like magic. My body is functioning better. I feel more feminine. I feel more sexy. I have more energy. And I'm just happy.
With Ambrin, the hot flashes stopped. I can sleep at night. My moodiness went away.
And now you can try this amazing breakthrough risk-free.
Getting similar results with other treatments can cost hundreds or even thousands. But a complete course of Ambren, designed for 6 months of relief, will cost you just five easy payments of $29.99. And it's backed by a 30-day money-back guarantee. But wait, call now and we'll waive one payment.
Ambren is a godsend.
If I had to describe Ambren in one word, I would say youth. Makes you feel young again. Makes you feel like yourself again.
Do yourself the biggest favor of your life and try Ambren.
And with this risk-free offer, you have nothing to lose except your hot flashes. But this offer will expire soon, so you must call now.
In India, Orphans Promise has been working hard to bring relief to children who are suffering there. Children like Jaskaran and Simran. Watch this.
An orphanage was the last place Jaskaran and Simran wanted to be. But their grandmother was sick and couldn't take care of them anymore. Her only choice was to bring them here, a Christian children's home in Delhi, India, sponsored by Orphans Promise.
I used to be very sad and cried a lot. I wanted to go home to my grandma. And what made it even harder was that all the kids here were Christians, but my sister and I were Sikhs.
Jaskaran refused to do his schoolwork and wouldn't play with the other kids. He also worried about his grandmother and prayed to the Sikh God to heal her, but she didn't get any better.
I was angry with my God for not healing my grandma. I loved her a lot. The other children at the home told me that Jesus could heal anybody. So I decided to see if what they said was true. I prayed to Jesus for my grandma's health. I also prayed with the other kids and house parents.
It wasn't long before Jaskaran and Simran received great news.
I found out that my grandma was completely healed. I ran and shared it with the other children. They reminded me about my challenge to God, and I agreed to accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Then I started to pray and read the Bible.
Jaskaran couldn't wait to share what he had learned with his sister.
Jesus is the one who was crucified for all our sins. I had never heard anything like that before. I cried and later accepted Lord Jesus as my personal Savior.
Jaskaran and Simran are doing well in school and have made lots of friends.
I thank God for bringing me to this home. I get good food to eat and new clothes to wear. But what matters the most is that I now have Jesus in my life.
This is the most wonderful children's home. I've been there. I've met this little boy. I've seen the children who live there. They really do minister to each other like that. They have all come to know that they have a father, though they may be in this children's home because their family here on earth was not able to provide for them. They have a father in heaven who loves them, who they know loves them, and who has made a way for them. They're being educated. They're being given hope in the future. We want to say thank you for making that possible for these children. They're precious, they're wonderful, they're gifted, and today they have a future because you cared enough to make a difference. If you'd like to be a part of what Orphans Promise is doing, you can give your very best gift by calling 888-777-1999, or you can give by logging onto cbn.com. But in advance, thank you on behalf of these children. Well, coming up, a car wreck left a teenager in a fight for her life. Hear her story right after this.
You may be eating genetically modified foods every day and not even know it. Some say you should be worried.
They refuse to look at the increasing evidence that GMOs are unsafe, both for the health and the environment.
Others, not so much.
All three U.S. government agencies have all reviewed the scientific facts, and they are completely safe.
Genetically modified foods, best hope for a world food shortage or worst nightmare. Hear from both sides on the 700 Club next.
Attention investors, now is the time to protect your retirement accounts and investments.
Excessive government spending is devaluing the U.S. dollar, and high rates of inflation are coming. Gold has tripled since 2001, and some experts predict the prices will climb another 100%. Buy gold now, direct and wholesale, with United Gold Group. The demand for gold around the world is higher than ever.
foreign countries like China and India are buying up gold at record rates. Why? What do they know that you don't?
Call now and get your Gold Investors Kit absolutely free. Call in the next 5 minutes and receive The Secret to Owning Gold in Your Retirement Account, also absolutely free. Just call 1-800-758-5070. That's 1-800-758-5070.
This could be the most important call you make this year. United Gold Group, investing in America's future.
Laura Tyler is a nurse and a walking miracle. But 7 years ago, Laura was a patient in ICU with less than a 1% chance to live.
We come to the door and there's two highway patrol officers with the two purses and two IDs, and are these your children?
He said there's been an accident, and Alicia crossed over the median on I-35, and then she hit a van, a full-size van, head-on, and when she did, she instantly died. I stood there for a moment, trying to grasp in that he had just told me that my firstborn child was gone, and it seemed like eternity. And then I said, what about Boo? And he said, well, they've air flown her to the trauma center. She's critical, and she's not gonna make it.
Roger and Dawn Lane prayed that God would spare their daughter, Laura, affectionately called Boo.
I felt the Spirit of God rise up within me. I heard the Lord begin to speak to my heart in that moment, and he said, I told you not to worry about Boo because she's in the palm of my hand. And it was at that very moment that I settled it, and I just put my hand on Roger's shoulder and I said, she will live and she won't die.
Earlier that day, the Lane's two oldest children, 19-year-old Alicia and 15-year-old Boo, were driving home from a Christian youth rally in Oklahoma City. Suddenly, an 18-wheeler passed Alicia and clipped her car. She lost control and went across the median into oncoming traffic. Alicia was killed instantly. MedFlight RN Nathan Dilley was working that afternoon and among the first on the scene. He knew it was a life or death situation for Boo.
I could tell by the condition of the car that it was pretty well smashed up and that she'd been thrown out. We could see someone doing resuscitation on her. So I knew that that was a serious situation. It doesn't get any worse than that. The chances of her living through that would be about 1% or less than 1% actually.
In addition to providing medical care on the 15-minute flight to the hospital, Nathan and his partner took another step. They prayed for their dying patient.
When we see someone that's this gravely injured that may not survive, we always make the decision to pray for them and just to continue to pray. And we realized ourselves that this was not going to be our care that brought this person through that, but God's hand.
Boo made it to the hospital. Dr. Roxy Albrecht led the trauma team who received her.
Boo came in as a priority one trauma or a level one trauma, and that's our highest level of activation. And her injury severity score was 41, which is very, very high. Over 25 is critical.
When the Lanes arrived at the hospital, they rushed in to see their daughter.
I knew that when they took me in to see Boo, that she wasn't going to look like my Boo. I already knew that. But you're never prepared for the moment that you're gonna see your child look that bad.
It was scary seeing her through all the hoses and the tubes, and there's nothing that she could do for herself. Laying there, and all you could do is just hope and pray and believe.
We were told that she had a traumatic brain injury. Her lungs had collapsed. She had broken scapulas, bilateral ones. The face bones were all fractured on the side of her face. It was all crushed and broke, and they had already told us she was going to need surgery on her leg.
As doctors worked to save Boo's life, her parents clung to their faith in God.
I knew that I had the promise of God to stand on, that no matter what she looked like, no matter what they said, I knew that I could still believe God for his word and that she was going to pull through this.
Dawn's boss at the time, a physician's assistant, came to the hospital to comfort the family and help them understand Boo's condition.
When they told us what all had happened,
I really didn't feel like that she would make it. I thought she was going to lose two daughters that day.
Doctors did all they could to save Boo's life. She survived the first critical hours, but there were no guarantees for long-term survival.
You know, the brain injuries are a black box. It all depends on where the injury is, what deficits you're going to have. It's hard to quantify what patients' outcomes are going to be until you just give them time.
The doctors and Boo's family were ready for the long and uncertain road ahead. But on the day of her sister's funeral, Boo woke up.
And it was right before we got there. It was right after the funeral. And when we walked in, she was awake.
Doctors expected Boo to spend 30 days in ICU and then several months in hospital rehab. But that wasn't necessary. Boo was formally discharged from the hospital in 27 days.
27 days. She came home with leg cast on. You know, she wasn't there, you know, mentally. You could see in her eyes that there were still pieces missing. But she was home. And that just goes to show you that God answers prayer. That God, when God gives you a specific word, that he has her in the palm of his hands. Nobody, nothing, no principality, no power, no human can take her out of his hands.
With every passing day, Boo continued to improve. She started making progress in physical therapy.
She still went through the things that you would have to go through. She just progressed a lot quicker than most people get to.
By the end of summer, she made a full recovery.
She had a lot of good care, and I would agree with that, but I think she had God's healing too.
It was nothing short of a miracle, a miraculous recovery that I've only seen a handful of times in the 20 plus years of doing this.
Boo returned to school in the fall and graduated as valedictorian of her class.
It's remarkable to come in unstable and to get resuscitated and go through the hospital that many days and get out and be a valedictorian. No, not miss a beat. That doesn't happen.
Boo has gone on to complete college with a degree in nursing. She's also married now to a guy her sister knew and wanted her to meet.
It was just really neat to find out that my sister was just, she was such a big part of his life too. God is always faithful. Just stick with him and he'll see you through anything that comes your way.
Just stick with him, he'll see you through whatever comes your way. When we start understanding that we're in the palm of his hand, that nothing can snatch us away, nothing. When we're persuaded, just as Paul was persuaded, that nothing can separate you from the love of Christ, when you know that and experience that, then yeah, you can go through anything. What are you going through right now? What do you need? Just realize when you turn it over to him. You know, so often in that piece, the parents were saying, we couldn't do anything. They're saying she couldn't do anything for herself. You know, when we start realizing that God is in control and he can take it if we just let him, if we just turn it over to him, we just rely on him. And when we do that, then we get access to miracle power, to transformational power, to recoveries that amaze doctors. He is the answer to every human need. So what's your need? What's your need? The Bible says that if we just take all of that, we take all that we need and we come to him, we say, Daddy, I need help with this, that he supplies all our need according to his riches and glory. Now, let's do that right now. And we're going to pray and we're going to believe God and watch for him to do miracles. Now, what's your need? Just say, okay, here's my need. Daddy, I need help with this. And let him do all the rest of it. You know, don't try to do it with your own effort. Don't think that, okay, I can help God out here. Let him do it and see what can happen to you. Let's pray. Lord, we just lift the needs to you. And Lord, so many people are just crying out for miracles. They need help financially.
They need help with their families. They need restoration miracles for marriages, for children who are estranged and gone away. And they need help with their bodies, Lord. They have pain. They have disease. They have infirmities. But in every instance, you're the answer. You're the solution. And so we just speak your provision over people right now. And Lord, as people are asking for jobs, for finances, Lord, I just ask for them to have favor, that your favor would be with them. You give us the power to get wealth. It's not anything we do on our own. You give that. And so we ask you for that now in Jesus' name. We ask for families. We ask for marriages to be restored. You place us in families. And so we just ask that all would be forgiven, that there would be reconciliation, husband to wife, wife to husband, parents to children. Let there be restoration in houses now. And now for these bodies that need healing, we just speak in faith, believing that by your stripes they were healed. It is already accomplished. We just receive it now. In Jesus' mighty name, be healed and be set free. There's someone, you've got a blockage in your, I think it's your small intestine. God is just unblocking that. And he's creating a way and a pathway. Everything's just going to flow smoothly. You don't need to worry about it. And that pain right now is leaving you. In Jesus' name, just take a deep breath and realize you can breathe in deeply in your innermost being, and there's no more pain. In Jesus' name, be healed and be made whole.
There's someone else. You have a child named Chelsea that you're praying for, and she has a couple of physical problems. One is evident on the outside, but the other is something internal that you can't see, and you've been praying for this for a long time. God is healing your child. Just receive that right now. Thank you, Lord. Someone else, you've had an accident. Not a car accident, but some kind of an accident where you fell on your back, and oddly enough, the residual of that is in your right hand, some kind of nerve damage or something. God is healing that hand for you right now. You're just going to feel a warmth come into your shoulder and down your arm, and that's all going to go back and function as normal.
Someone praying for chronic ear infections, and it's in your right ear, and you're feeling the pressure mount and you're worried that it's coming back. God's healing you right now. And you don't need to live in fear of infections anymore. You're being restored now in Jesus' name. Someone else has problems with your neck, and one of the discs is bulging in your neck. There's a lot of pain on the right side. God is just healing you now. He's taking all that away. He's restoring the disc. He's restoring full movement. What you couldn't do before, do it now. Begin turning your neck and realizing you've been released. The pain's gone now. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. If you've been touched by God, we want to share in your good report, so give us a call. We always rejoice in what God is doing in the world today. And if you've been healed and if you've been touched, let us know. We want to share the story. And we're here for you. So if you need prayer, we're here for you 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. And all you have to do, if you want someone to agree with you in prayer, is just call us. 888-777-1999. I believe we have some chat requests for ministry. Michelle, what do you have?
Yes, we have another prayer request. Gordon and Terry, Nadia says that she would like prayer that the Lord would heal her of stomach problems, hernia issues, and gastritis.
Okay. Is there another one, too? I think there's another one over there. Craig, you got one?
Yes. Adrian says, going in for a CAT scan this afternoon for pain in the left side, possible diverticulitis. She's been gripped with debilitating fear that something else may be wrong.
All right. We'll be praying for those throughout the day. If you're in the chat room, we'll be praying for you as well.
It's all the time we have for this program. We leave with this word from Psalm 19. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. God bless.